Major funding for these broadcasts has been provided by grants from M&T Bank, Perfect Building Maintenance, New York Community Bank, Collins Building Services, Pacific National Banks, CBIZ, Marks Paneth. Additional support for these broadcasts has been provided by grants from Bank of America, Douglaston Development, Levine Builders, Flushing Bank, Handro Properties LLC, ESSH Investments, James D. Kuhn Real Estate Center at Syracuse University, John Casimatidis, Red Apple Group, Markham LLP, Ocean First Bank, RPW Group, TD Bank, The One Stop Property Group, and these friends.
How do you become a master chef? How do you become a Michelin star chef? I don't know the answer, but today I have a young, dynamic chef who's become a Michelin star recently, who was working for restaurants at Michelin star, who came from a very humble background. And Austin Johnson is the chef proprietor and owner, co-owner of this wonderful restaurant, One White Street in Tribeca. Thanks for being here today.
Appreciate it. Happy to be
so
here.
Tell me about your parents and your grandparents who were saying to me about how they came to America after World War II.
Yeah, my great grandmother came from Lithuania with her son, and her son being my grandfather and her being my great grandmother. They were forced out of Lithuania. They were forced out of Lithuania during World War II. Landed in America and ended up in Omaha, Nebraska, working in the cattle business.
Sure.
She worked her butt off and raised a lovely family and my grandfather, incredible man. I always cherish my Lithuanian roots.
So you're in Omaha, Nebraska.
Yep.
Okay. Your parents said one day you'll be a good student, we'll pay for college, and if you're a bad student, you better find a new home.
Sure.
Okay. So what happens? Your first job at 13 was a cashier in the supermarket.
Yeah. I worked at Baker's Supermarket as a cashier. I started, I think, on my 14th birthday, which was the legal limit to start working in Omaha. I made $5.15 an hour. And I was ringing up groceries, but not for very long. I was one day asked to leave my cashier post to go help in the dish machine, in the dishwashing section of the bakery of the grocery store. And weirdly enough, it was at that moment washing dirty sheet trays and cake pans in this supermarket that I kind of fell in love with the idea of kitchen work, you know?
Really? What gave you the love of kitchen work?
I don't know. That big hose that you get to spray all the dishes with.
Sure.
And this like big dish machine that you don't have to like load. You know, I always hated doing dishes at my house after dinner. That was like my thing. I had to do the dishes. And I always poorly loaded the dish machine or left the sink dirty, or I just never did it half-assed, as my dad would say. I don't know, there was something about the convenience of this hose and this hot water and suds everywhere and the water all over the floor.
So did you leave the cashier role?
Yeah, I did the baker thing for just one day, and I think I put in my 2 weeks notice after that so that I could.
So you quit?
I quit, yeah.
And so did you have a new job because you were?
My mother was a waitress at a pretty fancy restaurant nearby to my house and my school. And, you know, I knew I was going to be working for the rest of my life. I 14, you know, I wanted to save up for my own car and you know.
But you did say to me that your father and your grandfather were involved with the candy business, and they had a very good business over there.
Well, I love candy. In fact, I remember going to his warehouse as a kid, and it's probably about the size of this room here, and it was just floor-to-ceiling candy bars. And he'd give me a big sack, and I get to go shopping. So I'm surprised I didn't get into that industry, but there, you know, I couldn't sit still in a school chair. I could barely stay awake in class. I just knew that whatever I was gonna do wasn't gonna be a desk job or kind of, you know, Omaha, it's kind of hard to be a fancy chef in Omaha. You know, there's only a handful of restaurants,
and the restaurant that you were working for was not really a fancy restaurant, but it was an upscale.
It was upscale.
It was an upscale restaurant. You said your mother was a server during the day.
Yep.
She did lunch. So how'd you get the job? You got a job as the busboy.
Yeah. Well, my mom, like, this is so embarrassing at the time, but she like talked to the manager, Jeff Overby. I'll never forget him, because he gave me my first opportunity, and she got me an interview with Jeff, and he thought it was kind of funny. You know, I was 14 years old, and I was all of 5'2". When I graduated high school, I was 5'4". So I'm now 6'4". So none of this makes sense, but I was just a small kid, probably looked like he was 10 years old, applying for this busboy position. And, you know, my mom told him I had great work ethic, I was gonna get the job done, I would work hard, which I was going to, and he gave me a shot, and I remember showing up my first night. I think my mom put like this tie on me or this vest. It was really embarrassing. She like dressed me up, and I like walked in there and was working with a bunch of grown-ups, you know, and kind of the underbelly of this world I'd never seen. You know, there was people outside smoking and drinking. I was just kind of like, it wasn't the grocery store. And I started bussing tables, you know. I was always proud of the fact I could get 5 glasses in one hand and get it cleared, and I had all these tricks to clear the bus, to bust the table like faster than, I wanted to get to the glasses before the server so I'd get a bigger tip out. Like, it was just, I was hooked. And then I started running food, because originally I wasn't allowed to run the food. But once I started paying attention to what these chefs were cooking, because it was an open kitchen, I could see right onto the stove. And once I started paying attention and seeing the food that was coming out of this kitchen, because at nighttime they kind of like kicked it up a little bit with their fancy food. Once I saw like the paprika and the parsley on the rims of the fettuccine Alfredo, and I saw the Greek salad coming out with olives and pita bread, I was like, wow, I gotta learn this. I gotta be back there.
So how long did you stay there at that restaurant?
Quite a while. I mean, I went to the kitchen. I asked Chef Bob.
Now, were you still at school? Or you...
Yeah, I was 14. Yeah, I was just a boy. I went to Chef Bob and I said, hey, what do I have to do to work in the kitchen and stop being a busboy? And he sent me home with his Culinary Institute of America handbook or whatever it is, the big book. And he said, if you read this from front to back, I'll give you a job in the kitchen. And a week later, I read it front to back and read about professionalism. I read about mother sauces and rabbit butchery and fish and all of these things that I just kind of always thought arrived in a package and not,
you didn't realize
from the ocean, or, you know, right. I just wasn't
so
exposed.
Did you stay there until you graduate high school?
No. The restaurant closed, and but Chef Bob gave me a job in the kitchen, and I got to start in the dish machine, which I loved because I was back on my
still
hose.
Still using the hose, right?
Yeah. And then one of the pantry, like garmage cooks, quit, and Chef Bob put me on the salad section, where I was dropping chicken tenders and making the Greek salad and grilling the pita and burning my hands and using knives and working on. I mean, I was really stoked about that, and then they would bring me over to the pasta station and they would teach me about how to reduce heavy cream into a sauce or mount it with butter or change the color or al dente pasta. I mean, it was really...
So this was your apprenticeship?
My early one, yeah.
But the second restaurant...
Well, that restaurant closed and I continued to work for the same ownership. The same ownership had a very famous restaurant in Omaha called Goldberg's. It's a burger joint. And they loved me so much because I was a hardworking 15-year-old at this time. And so they gave me a job in the burger joint. And they turned the back nine grill into a brand new Goldberg's. So they transformed the space, turned it into this kind of fanciful restaurant, into a burger joint. And I was on the opening team. I was like on the pre-opening team. I remember doing Friends and Family.
Right.
And I was like, I was opening a brand new restaurant with a very well-respected name of Goldberg's for Gene and Judy Corcoran, and I'll never forget that. And I thought I was the coolest guy in the world. My parents were coming into dinner, and I was cooking them burgers and making them hot wings and malts
and
sundaes.
So your parents at this time were proud of you?
Yeah, yeah, they were into it. You know, they were like, you know, they were happy I was working. I was saving a ton of money. I'd already bought my truck. I bought a Ford Ranger and cash because I was smart and saving my money. And so they were proud of my work ethic and continuing to get through school as a 15-year-old working probably 35 hours a week. And I was a part of the team. And I worked at Goldberg's for quite a while, a couple years. And I was at this point, you know, I was getting to be a junior or whatnot in high school. I became very close with my, I guess you call it a home ec teacher, but my cooking teacher in high school, Mrs. Biting. She really believed in me. Her and I started a culinary team, a competitive cooking team that started to compete. Well, we won the state championship in Nebraska, and then we competed on a national level, and I took last place. But her and I had an understanding that I would one day work at the best restaurants in the world. And she really, I mean, I still text with her every week. But she had a lot of confidence in me, and I guess nobody had a lot of confidence in anybody who wanted to be a chef, you know? Like, the only chef in the world was Emeril Lagasse, because that was the only chef on TV,
right?
You know? Maybe Wolfgang Puck if you knew about Spago, but there was no celebrity chef. There was no Bravo TV top chef.
Right.
It was not cool.
No, it wasn't cool to be a chef.
It wasn't cool.
Different world.
Different world.
So you graduate high school. You have this experience. What's the next step in your life?
I was in Omaha for a little bit. At this point, I was working not in burger joints, but I graduated high school. I was very proud of our culinary team and the trophies we won. I decided to not go to culinary school. I made a very, very thoughtful decision on whether I thought that was the right next step. I felt like I'd already been cooking for almost 4 years by the time my first day in culinary school would have came up. So I said, Mom, Dad, I'm gonna just continue on my path of cooking and not go to school. And wasn't a popular decision from them, and looking back, I very much respect that. But I used it as ammunition to like always be leveling up and always making sure that the next kitchen or the next job I took.
So how do you leave Omaha?
I had a job opportunity in Indianapolis on a golf course. It was very cool. My good friend referred me to be the sous chef of this country club, and the chef, I'll never forget, I was maybe 18, 19 years old. The chef flew me out from Omaha to Indy. I went to the country club. I met with the club manager.
And you liked the golf course.
I loved the golf course. I got to golf on Mondays. I cooked for the job. I had to put up a little tasting for the chef and proved I knew how to cook or create a dish. I must have had 35 cooks under me for the very first time in my life. I was responsible for banquets for up to thousands of people and weddings and in the swimming pool bar and grill and the half house on the 10th hole.
You're 18 and, years of age.
Yeah, young.
And so how long do you stay at the golf course?
So almost 3 years. I was there till I was over 21 because I remember my 21st birthday in Indianapolis, and that was that. My time, my chef was leaving the property, and it was just the club was going to go through a transition of ownership and management, and I was ready to level up.
So was that when you took the dart?
Yeah.
Okay. So you know, story with the dart.
Yeah, I was ready to move. I didn't know where I wanted to move. I was really fascinated by the Pacific Northwest. I was interested in Vancouver. I was interested in Seattle, Portland, you know, maybe Northern California. But I had a big map. I took a dart. I threw it up there towards the Pacific Northwest. And I'm a pretty good dart shooter. I was ranked fifth in the Midwest in darts when I was 19. And my parents were both top 10 in the world when I was a child. So darts is in my blood.
So the dart ended up where?
Right near Seattle. And I packed my car. I packed my Ford Explorer. I filled it up, drove from Indianapolis to Seattle in the greatest snowstorm, and I think in the history of the planet.
So what was your first job in Seattle?
Seattle, I worked at Cascadia on First and Bell for Chef Kerry Sear.
It's considered one of the best restaurants in the Midwest.
It was very famous. It was filled every night. And it was the fanciest, most beautiful food I'd ever seen and the most serious chef I'd ever worked under. It was the biggest opportunity I had gotten.
Now, Cascadia goes out of business, you said, right?
Cascadia went out of business. Chef Kerry decided to close it to open the brand new Four Seasons property on First and Union. And I helped him with that. It was an incredible opportunity to open a Four Seasons property. A lot of respect for that company and how they treat their staff. At least back then, I don't know about now, but opened the hotel, got the restaurant off the ground, and it was at that moment that my life truly changed, and I took a job at Canlis Restaurant, which is the most famous Pacific Northwest restaurant to ever exist, and one of the most famous restaurants in the country. I think it's 75 years old now, third generation. But the chef that I worked for there was Chef Daniel Humes' number two chef for several years.
And Daniel Humes created 11 Madison.
11 Madison Park, and you know, he was at Campton Place in San Francisco and Switzerland before that. You know, it was, Canlis was quickly became kind of the 11 Madison Park light of the Pacific Northwest because.
So you go to, is this when you go to 11 Madison?
Or no, I spent a couple years at Canlis in Seattle with the chef and I having a very clear understanding that after a couple years under his guidance, he would move me to New York and get me an opportunity to work at 11 Madison Park. And so in 2010, after working at Canlis for 2 years, as I told him I would, I quickly took a pit stop in Alaska, but ultimately ended up at 11 Madison Park in New York.
Okay, how long was the pit stop in Alaska?
3 months, from July to September.
Now, the 3 months was on a fishing boat, right?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
70,000 pounds of fish that the boat could hold?
Yep, every day, on a good day. We would catch just over 1 million pounds a season of wild Alaskan fish.
So you did that, and then you come to 11 Madison.
I did, yeah.
Okay, so the fame was 11 Madison.
Yeah, I showed up. Chef Daniel Humes handed me a piece of fish. He says, if you want to work here, you have to cook this perfectly, and you have to plate it for me, and I'll try it. And so I did, and I aced the test, like I usually did. I got the job.
Okay.
I was working there the following day.
So how long did you stay at 11 Madison?
I stayed at 11 Madison for 1 year, and the opportunity to go back to Alaska to do another 3 months and make another boatload of money which allowed me to not get chewed up and spit out, which New York does to a lot of cooks because it's expensive to live here. And, you know, back in 2010, I made $9 an hour in New York.
Right.
And, but I didn't care because
you wanted the
I made a ton of money in Alaska before I got there.
Right. So you had that as your savings.
100%. Situation. Yep.
So is that when you decide to go to Paris?
No. I left 11 Madison, went back to Alaska, and this was 2011. And it's always good to fish in Alaska on the odd year. So 2010, 2012 is going to be about half the return as 2011, 2013, and so on. So I didn't want to miss the opportunity of the 2011 season. Plus, I fell in love with the ocean. I fell in love with cooking on an ocean. I fell in love with the fishing industry. I fell in love with, you know, doing something outside of a Michelin-starred restaurant. It was just incredible to be out there on the ocean in this completely separate industry, something I'd never seen before, cooking fish that was 4 minutes old. It was pretty incredible.
After the second time on the boat.
Yep.
What?
I moved to Europe. I knew that this was the opportunity in my culinary career that I could afford to go to Europe, show up at the back door of these world-class, world-famous, top-of-the-line restaurants, such as Noma in Copenhagen or Oudslaus in the Netherlands. And back then, it was kind of okay to show up at the back door of a business and say, hey, I'm here to work for free. Don't worry about paying me. I've got all my room and board sorted out. I just want to be here. And so I did that. I showed up at Noma. And they said, hey, I don't see you on the clipboard to arrive today. And I'm like, hey, just let me in. And they did. And I spent 3 months there working for free with pleasure. With pleasure. I would do it again 100 times over. Got to meet Renee. I got to see Noma at its absolute prime when it was number one best restaurant in the world. I worked in Paris for 4 years and ran an incredible restaurant called Frenchie. And at Frenchie, I met hundreds of thousands of New Yorkers because they all travel to Paris and eat at Frenchie. And eventually, this amazing couple said, hey, we love you. We've eaten your food several times here in France. And we would love to open a restaurant with you in New York. And I said,
so okay. This is 2018? So they decided to open up a restaurant, be the financial backers of you on this
yep.
restaurant. Okay, how'd you find One White Street?
It was the first building we looked at, and really the only building we looked at. I walked the tour. At that time, it was a townhouse with bedrooms, bathrooms, closets. It wasn't a commercial space. It was residential. And I walked through the whole space, and I said, I think we have a Michelin-starred restaurant here. And
based on the physical location.
And the physical space, the location, what I could do conceptually inside of it, which would be very different to any other New York City restaurant. And we went for it. And it took us 3.5 years to construct 2,500 square feet. We did not open until late 2021.
When did you know that you had a Michelin star? They have 272 restaurants.
Last Thursday.
Okay, so let's talk about the Michelin star and its effect and how the restaurant is doing today.
Sure. I mean, you know, I'd be lying if I didn't say my goal in life professionally was a Michelin star. I mean, that's what I left my house for. It's what I left school for. It's what I've sacrificed my friends, my family, my relationships, my life for. So it is a very, it sounds, you know, a bit pretentious, but it's a lifetime achievement for me. And the fact that I could conceptualize that restaurant from somebody's home into a restaurant, and the fact that I could cook the food alongside of the team that I created and serve the food.
Right, so now in addition to getting the Michelin star last week, you have a farmer's market on Tuesdays, you said.
Yep, we have a farm in upstate New York that we try and grow as much of the produce as we possibly can for the restaurant. it's not 100% of the produce, but in the summer, it's about 85% of everything we serve in the restaurant comes from our farm.
And then in addition to that, you're opening up a bakery, you said?
Yep. Next door, we have a bakery opening in the next couple weeks. We'll do beautiful viennoiserie, baking, breakfast, lunch, coffee, takeaway, flower shop, magazine shop. It's going to be a little Hudson Valley-inspired market.
So look, for the kid who was short, who grew a foot during the period of time, from the kid who started, you know, as a cashier, so we've seen all different levels. You've accomplished quite a bit in your 37 years, and I hope to have you again on the Building New York, and I'm really proud that you came here.
Thank you.
And only the best of luck on One White Street.
Thank you.
In the future, and thanks for being here.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.